Good evening. Welcome to iFocus Lecture 106. This is the Glaucoma Module 6, and it's a masterclass by Dr. G. Chandrasekhar, who is the Vice Chairman of L.V. Prasad Eye Institute. GC, as he is popularly called, is an extremely good teacher, possibly one of the best in the region, especially on visual fields and optic disc analysis. And I have learned a lot from him as a resident at API Center when we used to listen to his lectures in Glaucoma Society meetings. And finally, as a junior to him, very, very junior to him, where he actually taught me how to do slit lamp biomicroscopic disc evaluation, which we were not doing at that time in API Center where I was trained. So GC is going to be extremely good in an interactive session, but Zoom is not a very good platform interaction, but he'll still try. GC, over to you. Dr. Harsh, you want to say something about GC?
Yeah, I just want to add that he is one of the most wonderful human beings. And whenever you send, I thought I was a good guy, but whenever I send patients to him, they always come back and tell me he's such a wonderful person, slightly better than you.
Vanita? Muted. Vanita, you're muted. Vanita, you're muted.
Yeah, sorry. You've done it all, and you have had, obviously, from a very tender, formative years, you've been in close association with him. Who doesn't know that he's the father figure of ophthalmology and glaucoma in India, and he's been associated with LVP right from its inception, and has, you know, moved on from as being a head of glaucoma, being director of education, to becoming the director of the campus here in Hyderabad, and also then moving on to becoming the vice chair. Where, you know, I think most people are aware of these excellent qualities. The one thing that I would like to add in this is that not many people know that outside LVP maybe, that he's very keen on biostatistics and loves to teach, and started a department in LVP on biostatistics, and also, you know, I think that's the reason why he can sort of make visual fields so simple for all concerned. So we actually welcome him to iFocus Online, which is a great platform for PG trainees, not just live, but also, you know, accessing it later in their own time. Team CFS welcomes you, Dr. GC.
Thanks for the kind words. I hope I can live up to the expectations. I'll start sharing my screen. I hope I am audible as well as my screen is visible.
Yes, please.
Thank you. So the topic is interpretation of the automated perimetry in glaucoma. To start with, I will probably step back. What we are trying to do in automated perimetry is actually look at the retinal sensitivity, and we define the retinal sensitivity as a stimulus intensity that is perceived 50% of the times. So identifying a retinal stimulus that is perceived 50% of the times at different retinal locations, and with all the innovations that we keep doing of condensing the time frames from full threshold to sitha standard to sitha fast and now sitha faster, and so on, we are putting the patient in a lot of stress. I think that's the first thing that we need to remember. Remember that nobody enjoys doing visual fields. A lot of my patients tell me that if you ask me to do the visual fields once more, I will stop coming to you. They don't mean it, but it conveys the kind of pain that one has to go through when one does the visual field. In a typical situation, we are asking them to do the visual fields because we are going to tell them either you have glaucoma or you don't have glaucoma. Or we are going to tell them that your glaucoma is going to get worse, so you need more treatment or surgery. Under that circumstance, doing a visual field examination, I think, is very stressful. That's the first thing that we need to remember. To drive the point home, let me share this case with you. So this 30-plus-year-old patient, at the prime of his life with a lot of responsibilities just added probably, was told that he has glaucoma or he is a glaucoma suspect and his visual fields were done. And you can see that over a very short period of time, how his visual fields were deteriorating very rapidly. And he was actually told that he needs an MRI, he needs permission to do OCT every 3 months, visual field every 3 months, and so on and so forth. So with the responsibilities, when he goes on the net and sees that it's a blinding disease, his personal life is completely shattered, and you cannot expect him to do a good visual field examination with that kind of a time frame. So he came to me. Fortunately for me, he came with these disc photographs, which to me look like large disc physiological cups. And so I told that we should do the visual fields without dilation, without distorting the iron segment in any way. And I went and spoke to the optometrist who was doing the visual fields that this patient is stressed. You need to be careful and be with him when you're doing the visual fields. And I reassured him that before sending, because of the disc photographs, that you may not be having glaucoma, but we need to get the visual fields done. With that reassurance, his visual fields were completely, almost completely normal compared to what you start off here. So I think the first lesson to learn in doing a visual field examination for patients is that we, as the doctors and our team, have to understand what the patient is going through and have to be very supportive. The fourth edition was what we were reading earlier, and very recently the fifth edition of this perimetry by Anders Hale and Mike Patel has come very recently. I had the fortune of having the soft copy sent to me by Anders Hale himself. So one of the things that this perimetry book says is that perimetry is automated, but the patients are not. So that's the fundamental thing I was trying to tell you, we need to remember. And Talveer has very in detail told all the things that we need to inform the patients about before they get onto the visual field test and the information that they need to know. And there are a lot of things that are given in the book, and we ourselves have actually got a pamphlet made in different languages giving the instructions. And the moment we tell the patient that you are going to get the visual fields done, we hand this over to them, ask them to go through this, re-instruct again before the visual field test is done, and then have the patient do the visual fields. So that is as far as the humanistic aspect of visual field evaluation is concerned, which we should never forget. The fundamental two sets of questions we ask when we ask the patient, send the patient for visual fields. The first set of question is we are interested to know whether it is glaucoma or not. And the second question that we are interested in is whether the glaucoma is stable or it is progressing. This talk will focus on the diagnosis alone and not on progression. But to be able to answer this question well, we need to actually answer these two questions. Has the test been carried out well? And did the patient perform well? So from the perspective of the second two questions, okay, the other theme that is there throughout the talk is these difficult concepts that we need to understand. The last one that is there in the title of clinical correlation is probably straightforward, but to be able to do that, we need to understand the concepts of what is normal versus what is abnormal. In that context, I will talk a little bit about p-value and what is abnormal versus what is disease. I will talk briefly about prior probability in that concept, in that understanding. So those two are a little heavy. When I get there, I will tell you to wake up a little bit and then pay a little more attention. So to answer this question, is the test carried out well? Talveer has covered in great detail. I will just give some examples of what it actually means in the clinic. So the first question is has the patient understood the way the test needs to be done? So this is an example of three fields done on the same day, starting from the first field, which is very bad, to the third field on the same day, the patient's performance has improved tremendously. So that means that it has taken a long time for the patient to understand. This is the second example. We keep talking about cloverleaf deformity. Very old example. Sorry for the poor printout. The four cardinal points, when they are checked, the patient was attentive and subsequently he decided not to participate in the test anymore. That's where you get a cloverleaf deformity. A direct opposite of that, you have the first four cardinal points not tested properly. Zero decibel sensitivity there or very low sensitivity. Once he understood the test and started doing the test more properly, you have good, relatively good values throughout the rest of the test. So that's how we have to understand. And the questions of whether the correct refractive error has been correctly given, the pupil size and things like that, along with what program, and are the ones that were covered in the basic talk. But we will try to give some clinical examples again. So before we proceed further, I think to be able to look at the visual field in a very systematic manner, generally people tend to divide this into 8 zones, and we will go by zone. In zone 1, the patient's details are there, what program and what strategy are used, the visual acuity of the patient and the correction that was used, whether it's appropriate or not, we need to see. The date, the time at which the test was done, and the age of the patient are given. So we need to enter the date of the birth correctly so that we can get the correct comparisons. The use of 30 or 24-2 with a 6-degree resolution and the central 10 degrees with a 2-degree resolution was talked about and discussed at length last time. So what does it translate to? This patient has a 0.5 visual acuity, which means 6-12, and all the points in the 24-2 program are showing a sensitivity of 0 decibels. As opposed to that, this is a very old example, once again, more than 30 years old. At the time when the Humphrey visual fields were just coming in without stat pack analysis, we had only this 3-in-1 printout without any stat pack analysis. But what you can see is that the visual field is normal. And because at the time, the kinetic perimetry also was being done simultaneously, this is an example I got from a friend in San Francisco. There is a classical superior paracentral scotoma that is diagnostic of glaucoma. So this classical superior paracentral scotoma diagnostic of glaucoma has been missed by the automated perimetry. And why does this happen? That the patient's vision is good, no sensitivity at all, and a scotoma is missed. That is because of the 6-degree resolution. So when you are looking at the visual field in an advanced glaucoma, or you are suspecting a central field defect to be present because of your clinical examination, like what you see here, or if you have a central defect like this, to be able to examine that defect more carefully and also follow it up more intently, you need to do a 10-2 program. A true defect in the central field will exaggerate or enlarge when you do a 10-2 program. The 24-2C program was introduced with the idea that the central points, more additional central points are there, but they still do not have the resolution of what you would have in a 10-2 field. So this is another example to understand the concepts. A 10-2 field with a 2-degree resolution with a vision of 20/20, but the central points are all having a zero sensitivity. We know that only fovea has 20/20. How come that there are no central points that are visible even if you have a 10-2 program with a 2-degree resolution? Same patient with a macular program has many more points now that have a retinal sensitivity compared to what you saw before. But if you pay attention to this particular plot here, each of those numbers are a second time. There is a second number given within brackets below that. But if you see the 10-2 program, it's only once. So the points in 10-2 are thresholded only once, and the points in the macular program are thresholded a second time. So that's the detail with which we need to understand the machine and put it to use if you want to do the examination properly. The questions of, is the test carried out well, is done. Did the patient perform well, is the next one that we are talking about. From that perspective, we look at zone 2. What are the fixation losses, false positives and false negative errors, and the duration of the test that has taken is the other thing that we'll show there. So if the patient is trigger happy, you will have a lot of fixation losses and false positive errors. On the grayscale, you will have what is called as a white scotomas, because the sensitivity is more than 40 in the periphery, which is not possible at all. So that's what results in so-called white scotomas. The mean deviation will be on the positive side. The glaucoma hemifield test will be abnormal high sensitivity. The pattern deviation plot is worse than the total deviation plot. So this is what we classically teach, that if this is something like this, you need to repeat the visual field test. But this is an example of a patient from 2008 to 2010, consistently having abnormal points in the inferior nasal step area. The total deviation plot, the pattern deviation plot is consistently worse than the total deviation plot. On the disc examination, you have a superior nerve fiber layer defect that correlates with the visual field defect that you see here. So complicated statistics of how these pattern and total deviation plots are generated and what is the limitations of the normal normative database that you may have is something that needs to be paid attention to. But whatever lessons we learn, there will be some exceptions is what I'm trying to point out. As far as the false negative errors are concerned, if the patient is not paying attention and there are false negative errors, the visual field look like it is probably worsening, minus 4 mean deviation on a 10-2 program to minus 17. But the false negative errors are 0 in the first field, minus 8% in the second field, and 15% in the third field. So if the field looks like it is progressing, you need to pay attention to false negative errors also, along with the other things. Moving on to zone 3, you look at the grayscale. Two examples I've talked about already. And what kind of a field effect that you have on grayscale is something that you can use to explain to the patient. And white scotomas is something that we talked about. So moving on, zone 4 and zone 5, the total and pattern deviation, numeric as well as the probability plots, is the goldmine. That is what we have invested our money for. And that is where we are going to decide whether the patient has glaucoma or does not have glaucoma. So to do that, we need to step back and understand the concept of what is normal versus what is abnormal. It is a statistical concept. What is abnormal versus what is disease is a clinical concept. These are the ones that we need to understand. So to understand the normal versus abnormal, the p-value, these are the things that you have on the printout. So p less than 5% means that this kind of an abnormal threshold value that you see in a given patient at a given location is found in 5% of the normal population. Less than 2% means that found in 2% of the normal population. Less than 0.5% means that is found in less than 200 of the normal population. Greater the abnormality, more likely to be the severity of the disease if it clinically correlates. Just a statistical abnormality per se does not mean that the patient is diseased. So this p-value is got by comparing the threshold that you get in the patient from age-corrected normals. And whatever is present in the lower fifth percentile, that is present in less than 5% of the normal population, is considered to be abnormal. So an abnormal value is not same as disease, is the point that I'm trying to make out. If you look at the intraocular pressure distribution, to make things more clear, 2.5% of the normal population will have an intraocular pressure of more than 21. We call them as ocular hypertension. But there are people who will have an intraocular pressure less than 20 that still have glaucoma. People who have pressure more than 20 that do not have glaucoma. A large number of people with glaucoma will have a high intraocular pressure. But people with low intraocular pressure can still have glaucoma. And people with high intraocular pressure may not have glaucoma. So that's what we understand clearly, normal tension glaucoma and ocular hypertension. The similar concept needs to be understood here. So if you say that a retinal sensitivity at a given location is 10 decibels and P is less than 0.5%, what we are saying is that at that location, a retinal sensitivity of less than 10 decibels is found in less than 1 in 200 people. The important thing that we need to put on the corollary and try to understand, which it took long for time for me to understand, is that the more number of points that you check, by chance, you will come up with some points that are abnormal. So when you have your imaging technologies that look at 10,000 and 20,000 and 50,000 points, and all of them are being compared with the normal population, the greater the number of data points that you have, if you decide 5% of normal is abnormal, you will have a larger number of abnormal points when you check more points, is the thing that we need to understand. So, repeating again, abnormal at whatever p-value is not same as diseased. Clinical correlation is required to say if a given abnormality indicates a specified disease. This concept I will reinforce with multiple examples as we go forward. So, to drive home the same point of statistical versus clinical abnormality, I put this example of an inferior nerve fiber layer defect with a notch with a superior paracentral scotoma, clear-cut glaucoma. What is the imaging here saying? All the quadrants are normal. If you look at the printout in a little more detail, the disc area in this patient is 1.48 millimeter square, and it is lower than the normative range that the machine has. And pay a little more attention to detail. What it says is that classification is based on Moorfield's classification, is based on statistics. Diagnosis is physician's responsibility. So which means that the machines cannot diagnose our conditions. We need to take the driving seat. So getting back to the statistics that are there in the visual field printout, what do we have? We have the total and pattern deviation probability plots the global indices. So to look at the total and pattern deviation probability plots, what I have done here is to put the total and pattern deviation probability plot here, the numeric printout of the zone 8 and the probability values. I'm sorry why this is not showing up, but this is approximately a 50-year-old patient. So if you see this particular location here, -3 in the total deviation plot, numeric plot, shows means that in an approximately 50-year-old patient, the possibility of finding this kind of a 3 decibel depression is less than 5% of normal population. Similarly, the other points are given in the total deviation plot, 18 decibel depression found in less than 0.5% of the normal population. Then whatever is there in the total deviation probability and numeric plot is given as the pattern deviation probability plot. In the pattern deviation probability plot, it is corrected for a cause for a generalized depression. The machine does not know if it is there or not there, but just corrects for that and then gives if there is any localized effect or not. We'll talk about that subsequently. So total deviation plot is a point by point difference from the expected values of age-related normals. We pay attention to the number of points that are abnormal, how severely abnormal are they, and where are they located. So it was discussed in the previous session. That's why I'm going into the details here. If you look at these points now here, 7th best value or the 85th percentile, if you count the numbers here, -2 is the 7th best depressed point. That is why when you correct for the pattern deviation plot, -2 has become 0. It's not as straightforward as that because -8 and -10 here have become -6 and -7. Here it is subtracted by 3 decibels and not 2 decibels. So there are more sophisticated complications, mathematics involved there. So the pattern deviation probability plot is what we showed after correcting. So here in the total deviation probability plot, many points are depressed. But if you look at the pattern deviation probability plot, there is an inferior nasal step and an incomplete inferior arcuate scotoma. Whether that correlates with a superior nerve fiber layer defect is what will decide whether this is glaucoma or not. So this is the same patient before and after cataract surgery. The total deviation plot is grossly abnormal. The pattern deviation plot shows the localized scotoma. Here, both the total as well as the pattern deviation plots are not much different because there is not much of an element of generalized depression produced by the cataract. Both of them are more or less same. Moving on, talking about zone 6 and zone 7, these are the global indices and the glaucoma hemifield test and the visual field index. Some more mathematics there. So the idea of a global index is to compress all the information present in the visual field into a single number. We go with two numbers, the mean deviation and the pattern standard deviation. The idea to compress that would be, if you want to compare the patient's visual field over a period of time, you can compare the global indices of what is happening to the patient's visual fields over a period of time. If you have a cohort of patients, you want to pick up only early glaucomas, you can pick up patients with a global index of mean deviation less than -6. If you want advanced glaucoma more than -20 or things like that is what you can do. The mean deviation is an aggregate of the deviation that you see in the total deviation numeric plot. So you get a single number and the statistical abnormality for that number found in less than 1% of the normal population. The pattern standard deviation, on the other hand, is an indication of localized effect. What it does is normally the central points are in the low 30s, and towards the periphery, you will get into high 20s or low 20s. And it's following a smooth pattern of 30, 30, 25, and 20. In the opposite direction, it is 30, 0, 25, and 26. So it's not following that smooth pattern. So when it is not following that smooth pattern, you get a high pattern standard deviation. It is similar to the surface asymmetry index that you would have in a corneal topography to pick up keratoconus. So one of the things that we can say here is that the mean deviation will be grossly abnormal if there is a very advanced field effect or if there is a non-glaucomatous cause like a cataract. in the presence of a non-glaucomatous cause like a cataract and glaucoma, the mean deviation may be abnormal, but the pattern standard deviation will be more indicative than of the amount of glaucoma damage than the mean deviation. In early glaucoma with no cataract or no cause for generalized depression, the mean deviation will be normal, but the pattern standard deviation will be abnormal. In the glaucoma hemifield test, based on the kind of nerve fiber layer distribution that we have, we look at the pattern, compare the values of the mirror images of cluster of points to the superior to the inferior hemisphere. So if the value in one of the hemispheres is significantly abnormal compared to the opposite hemisphere, found in less than 1% in the normal population, you call it outside normal limits. If the difference is borderline, found in 3% of the normal population, you call it borderline. If both the superior and inferior are abnormal, but there is no difference, you call it as a generalized reduction of sensitivity. If they are higher than the age-corrected normal, you call it as abnormal high sensitivity. If none of those four parameters are satisfied, then you say the glaucoma hemifield test is within normal limits. Visual field index is once again a global index that summarizes the visual field in a value of 0 to 100, indicative of the residual visual function of that patient, of that eye, is typically not affected by cataract. It is calculated from the pattern deviation probability plot, but if the mean deviation crosses 20 decibels, it tends to be calculated from the total deviation plot, so the calculation will go haywire. We need to pay attention to that. The calculation of what is the remaining visual field at a given point is what is calculated, and that is weighted for the eccentricity. Central points are given more weightage, peripheral points are given less weightage. The advantage of this is that how is the visual field index doing over a period of time for progression analysis is what we can see. So this is an example where before trabeculectomy, there is a rapid progression of the visual field, and after surgery, the visual fields are stable. So that's what you can see. Without changing the baseline, continues to show progression, but this bit is before surgical intervention. This is after surgical intervention, before and after. That is how the VFI can be used. So all the statistical abnormalities that we talked about for the presence of a glaucomatous visual field defect have been summarized by Anderson as the following three criteria, which all of us know by heart. So in the pattern deviation probability plot, three or more non-edge points, if you're doing 24-2, you can consider edge points, are depressed at P less than 5%. One of them is depressed at P less than 1%. They all are present in a cluster. Pattern standard deviation is abnormal at P less than 5%. And glaucoma hemifield test is outside normal limits. So those are the three parameters that we take. What level of abnormality will indicate what disease is what we need to see? So any diagnostic test cannot be a substitute for poor clinical skills, but can only be a complement, is the point. The idea that I want to put here is that all of us have made the statement, this is bound to happen. Whether it is stock market, whether it is elections, or whether it is somebody going along with a young girl, boy, together, getting married or not married. So we made the statement, this is bound to happen. We also made the statement, this is impossible. So the same philosophy is used in the evaluation of SITA standard versus SITA fast or in a published literature. What we are looking at is the incremental change in the likelihood of something happening. Based on the clinical examination, is the abnormal visual field likely to indicate glaucoma or not, is the Bayesian prior probability that is being talked about. So for that, what we need to do is we need to get into structure function correlation. So from the structure function correlation point of view, I have multiple points that I have listed out, and we'll go by them one by one. So this is what the Zeiss machines can do for us. You have the disc photographs, the red of the imaging technology is overimposed on the green, on the black of the visual field. If they correlate with each other, so where the red is and the green, the black of the visual fields, superior to inferior, are correlating, So this is a glaucomatous field effect, is what the machine can do. But what we do clinically is we have a visual field test like this. PSD is flagged off. GHT is outside normal limits. A cluster of more than 3 points. All three Anderson's criteria are satisfied. Whether this is glaucoma or not will depend upon whether we can pick up this nerve fiber layer defect inferiorly that correlates with this visual field defect. Another example of an abnormal visual field, whether this is glaucoma or not will depend upon whether you pick up the subtle notch, the hemorrhage there, and the inferior nerve fiber layer defect. So to take that a little further, what we can do is not only decide whether glaucoma is present or absent, but based on the disc evaluation, the structure function correlation should tell us which is more severe, which is less severe. So if I say that in all these three, there is going to be a superior arcuate scotoma, which is going to be more severe. The nerve fiber layer defect here and the notch here is relatively small. This seems to be broader than that, but there is still some tissue remaining here. This seems to be the broadest nerve fiber layer defect and the broadest notch, very close to the fovea. So if you make that, the central one is the most severe visual field defect. The first one is little, the least visual field defect. And the third one is more than the first and less than the second. So that kind of a correlation is what we need to develop over a period of time. In the interest of time, I will skip that. This thing, second example that I had that I would have probably for interaction. I will move on to reinforce the concept of the unreliable or weak statistical abnormality with a strong structure function correlation. Because if you have that strong structure function correlation, your prior probability of the disease is more. Even a weak statistical abnormality can indicate a disease. So this is an example of what looks like a poor photograph, but there is an inferior excavation. My optometrist felt that the disc was healthy. I felt that there was an excavation taking place inferiorly. And if you see here, GHT is borderline. The PSD is flagged off only at 10%, but there are a cluster of 3 points in the superior arcuate area that are statistically abnormal, satisfying only one of the Anderson's criteria. Because it correlates with the clinical abnormality, I would call this as early glaucoma. Based on what I will say subsequently, this is necessary to do a 10-2 visual fields in this situation also. One of the other concepts that we need to remember in this context here is that all these comparisons are with age-corrected normals. But what the patient's visual sensitivity was before he developed glaucoma is what the machine or you or I do not know. If you take the example of typhoid, what is the diagnostic Vidal test? A rising titer. So we need to know what is the baseline and the titer has to increase. To put it in better perspective, if a 65-year-old, 5 feet 5 inches height man, average weight is going to be 60 to 65 kg, and I tell you his weight is 62, is it normal or abnormal? All of us will say without biting an eyelid, it is normal. But if I tell you that he was weighing 80 kg 6 months ago, you are worried about what cancer he has. So this is a limitation of comparing with normal population across the age, but not knowing what the patient started off with. So here is an example that has all GHT is borderline. The pattern deviation plot is worse than the total deviation plot, which is what we said is indicative of a abnormal false positive errors and trigger happy patient. P also is, the mean deviation also is positive. But whatever defect we see here is actually correlating with an inferior nerve fiber layer defect and a notch. So that's why even with a weak statistical abnormality, this is definitely glaucoma because it correlates. One more example, low test reliability. PSD is flagged off at 5%. GHT is outside normal limits. These 2 points are the ones that we are interested in. And they correlate with a beautiful nerve fiber layer defect superiorly. So in spite of an unreliable visual field test, this is diagnostic of glaucoma. For baseline, you may have to repeat the test once more. Another extreme example, PSD is not even flagged off. GHT is within normal limits. some points in the inferior arcuate area satisfy one criteria. There is a superior nerve fiber layer defect. If you are not convinced, we can do the OCT and see the abnormality in the nerve fiber layer that correlates with the visual field defect. So that is diagnostic of glaucoma. So moving on, we keep talking about structure loss precedes function loss based on in the early glaucoma. And this happens because of more than one reason, because this is also correlated with structure function correlation. The point is that visual field defects take a longer time to develop. Disc and nerve fiber layer changes occur earlier than visual field changes is what we are repeatedly told. Of the multiple reasons for that, one of them being the visual fields is a log scale and the RNFL is a linear scale is a different issue. But take this example. The visual field is within normal limits by all criteria. And there is a definite anatomical abnormality. And if you do a 10-2 field, there is a huge superior arcuate scotoma that is completely missed by the 24-2 field. So we would have called this as structure loss precedes function loss if you had not done the 10-2 field. So that's the point I'm making. So looking at structure function correlation in a greater depth, this is the recent article that I read. So if you look at the superior optic nerve vulnerable area and the inferior optic nerve vulnerable area, the inferior vulnerable area significantly involves the macular area. The superior vulnerable area does not involve the macular area. So just looking at the nerve fiber layer and just looking at the optic nerve head on OCT is not enough. We need to pay attention to the macular area also is the point that this is making. So if we need to pay attention to the macula, this is the central 8 degrees of the macula that represents the 10-2 field. And you don't have a high resolution visual field examination there, highlighting the same point. The inferior actually encroaches onto the macular area. The superior stays away from the macular area, the vulnerable zone of the optic nerve that gets damaged in glaucoma. So from that perspective, this was one of the questions that came up, I think, in the previous discussion. When do you perform a 10-2 field? So if you're performing a 10-2 field only in an advanced glaucoma, you are not doing the right thing. So 24-2 visual fields miss central defects on 10-2 that can be picked up on 10-2 is what this article says. Glaucoma suspects close to 40%, ocular hypertension close to 35%. If the 10-2 fields are not done, they can be missed, is the point. So before concluding, some examples of a non-glaucomatous field loss and some artifacts with structure function correlation that we need to see. So here is an example of a superior scotoma that is respecting both the vertical and horizontal meridian. I don't find anything abnormal on the inferior neuroretinal rim. This is a 90D lens examination photograph. I don't find anything abnormal in the inferior neuroretinal rim because the image is reversed. But when we look at the foveal macular area and the retina carefully, there is an evidence of a past venous occlusion that has resulted in this kind of a field effect. So one more example of a field effect respecting vertical and horizontal meridian, an evidence of past venous occlusion that correlates, and the patient gives evidence of that past venous occlusion. A classical inferior nasal step produced in an ocular hypertension one-eyed patient by photocoagulation done for Eales disease. An inferior non-arcuate repeatable field effect produced by a nerve fiber layer defect limited to the superior 12 o'clock area, a condition called superior segmental optic nerve hypoplasia. This is what looks like an inferior arcuate inferior field defect produced by glaucoma. But if you look at the nerve fiber layer pattern, if a field defect has to be produced, the field defect has to be narrower at the optic disc and broader as you go towards the periphery. Here, it seems to be broad at the optic nerve head, narrow here, and then broadening here again, does not follow the arcuate pattern. So this is probably an artifact because the patient's head moved away from the machine. Repeat the visual field test properly, then you get a normal visual field. One more example of the same thing. So this is what it translates to clinically. An inferior field defect produced for the first time in a patient that is being followed up for glaucoma. my optometrist got biased and said there is a superior notch. I was not convinced that there is a superior notch. It does not correlate. So I told them to repeat the visual field test properly, positioning the patient, and the visual field effect disappeared. So this is the kind of structure function correlation in the clinic that we should do. So the kind of visual field loss that this patient has over a period of time, fluctuating all over the place. So this is the kind of visual fields that the patient has. I keep writing unreliable visual fields, well-controlled IOP, disc is healthy. No glaucoma being followed up locally for IOP, unreliable visual fields comes only once a year to me for the visual field examination. HVF and disc are not correlating. I'm not enhancing his therapy. We're just continuing the same way. And finally, a normal field. First time normal HVF, I've been waiting for this for a long time is what I wrote in my notes there. So I went very fast. I think we have enough time for discussion. So to summarize, what we looked at is to answer the questions, is it glaucoma or whether it is stable or not. We are focusing only on glaucoma in this talk. We need to answer the questions, is the test carried out well and did the patient perform the test well, are the questions that we need to answer. And we need to understand what is the p-value, what is the statistical abnormality that is given by the test result, and clinically correlate and differentiate between a statistical abnormality given by the test result, however sophisticated that test result may be. We need to be in the driving seat and we need to decide based on the prior probability of examination and the clinical findings whether that statistical abnormality translates to a disease or not. In the context of visual field examination, that is done by structure function correlation. Thank you for your attention. We can take questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. JC. As usual, it has been very comprehensive. We do have a few questions, but before that, can I invite my chair and co-chair to give us their comments?
Harsh is not there, I think. So it was, as usual, very, very good lecture by Dr. JC. You know, you always learn a lot. Tell Harsh, have come, so you start first.
No. I don't know. And there's really nothing much to say except that we keep learning from him all the time. Every time in each lecture, he was so beautifully explained. And I think it'll be good if we can allow, I think the time they may not be too much. Let the students ask their doubts, I think. Rafiq, you want to say?
Yeah. So, you know, there are so many things what Dr. GC used to teach us, and he did not tell, you know. He always used to teach us, you know, always see that how much time the patient has taken to perform the test for the right eye and how much time the patient has taken to perform the test for the left eye. If there is a difference, you know, by looking at that, you get lots of information. Whether the patient was fatigued or patient has not performed well, he was not attentive. Similarly, you always look at that which eye was performed first. So these are all very, very small things. But, you know, when you have a field chart in front of you, it is not only important that you just look at the gray scale or the total deviation or the pattern deviation and make the conclusion. So every single thing is important. That is what Dr. GC taught us. And, you know, the mistake is committed from both the sides. The machine can commit the mistake and the human being can commit the mistake. The only advantage with the glaucoma is that, you know, if you are committing a mistake and it's an early glaucoma, then it's not a big time, because the simple reason is that the glaucoma never progresses fast and hopefully you would be able to pick up the next time. So it is always better to chase 6 degree and 2 degree or 10 days two and 24 days two. But obviously by doing a good thorough clinical examination and adopting a holistic approach, you would be able to pick up the early defect somewhere, either through the nerve fiber layer defect or through the OCT, or maybe by doing the other perimetric strategy like 10 days two or so. So there are so many things to learn from Dr. GC. Thanks a lot, Dr. GC. Every time for 30 years, I am learning from you. Fantastic.
Right. Can we take some questions now? There's a question which asks, why is MD denoted in minus and PhD denoted in plus?
Dr. GC? So mean deviation is the amount of depression that is there in the aggregate of the visual fields points that are tested compared to age-corrected normals. So it can be plus if the average sensitivity is more than the age-corrected normal. I've shown you a couple of examples where the mean deviation was plus also. If the mean deviation is significantly plus, because we don't have phantoms doing the visual fields normally in the clinic, you think that the patient is trigger happy and is overperforming, or fixation losses are there. Pattern standard deviation, as opposed to that, is not a comparison with age-corrected normal. It's only how deviant are the adjacent values. So if the adjacent values are significantly different from each other, then you get an abnormal, you get a pattern standard deviation. So pattern standard deviation does not have the minus sign. It's only a number. Higher the pattern standard deviation, greater is the localized scotoma that is present. Because pattern standard deviation is calculated based on the abnormality that is there compared to the adjacent points. If you have a very advanced field effect, like what you have in mean deviation being more than, worse than minus 20 decibels, we can't say more because it's a minus number, worse than minus 20 decibels, it's the pattern standard, pattern deviation probability plot is not calculated. And the pattern standard deviation also actually can reduce when the mean deviation is worse than minus 20 decibels. I hope that answers.
Sir, yeah, sure. Yeah. Sorry, any comments?
At this point, sir, can you also clarify, because that day also we had a little confusion about how exactly is the PhD calculated? Is it the first 17 points and what Talveer was saying, or is it the seventh most sensitive point which is reduced? Can you just tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I tried covering it. Probably I was very fast in the slides that I put together. Yeah. So essentially, it is the 85th percentile. There is no reason why 85th percentile is taken. It is like, to put in layman's terms, if you say that the examination paper was very tough, so let us change the pass mark from 35, from 50 to 35, so that we are giving 15 grace marks to everybody. Mm-hmm. Okay. Because of the generalized reduction of sensitivity that is there with a myosed pupil or a high refractive error, uncorrected refractive error, cataract, the machine does not know. You need to decide what is the reason for that. So for that, 15 percentile grace marks are given to the threshold sensitivity for all points. So a point that is depressed, if the difference between the best and the seventh best point is 2 decibels, like in the example that I showed, in the total deviation plot, if the point is depressed by 7 decibels, it is corrected to depressed by 5 decibels. So that the localized scotomas can be highlighted in the background of the diffuse loss of sensitivity that is there because of the cataract usually.
Yeah. The other question here is, what is the significance of Anderson's criteria? Is one of what one of the attendees wants to know.
The presence of a localized scotoma in a cluster is what we are looking at. So to define that localized scotoma, Anderson's criteria are three statistical parameters that are taken based on the pattern deviation probability plot and the global indices along with GHT. So if the GHT is abnormal, there is likely to be a localized scotoma because of the difference in the average value of the cluster in the superior to the inferior MHCR compared. The pattern standard deviation is an indication of a localized scotoma. So if it is P less than 5%, there is likely to be a localized scotoma. And these two are validated by actually looking at the pattern deviation probability plot and identifying more than 3 points that are in a cluster depressed at less than 5%, at least one of them depressed at 1%. So all of them are statistical parameters. So what Anderson's criteria is doing is to making our attention focus on statistical abnormality. And there are 3 criteria. So if all 3 are abnormal, statistically very strong possibility that the patient has disease. If only one of them is abnormal, statistically the possibility of disease is very low. Even a low statistical possibility will translate into disease if clinically you are suspecting the disease to be very strongly present. If clinically you are not suspecting the disease to be present based on your disc evaluation and the nerve fiber layer loss or neuroretinal rim loss in the corresponding hemisphere, even if the statistical abnormality is significant, it may not indicate disease. So that's the structure function correlation that we need to do based on the statistical abnormality given by the visual field and the clinical probability of the disease being present based on your clinical examination.
Right. Now, in all likelihood, because we talk about non-edge points, this was made at a time when 30-2 was more prevalent. What is the significance of that in 24-2?
24-2, there are no non-edge points. All points can be taken.
All points. So that's a clarification that was required. And a question that I have not understood, maybe you can make some sense of it. What does bearing of blind spot look on visual field? Bearing of blind spot.
Bearing of blind spot is a term used for kinetic perimetry. Mm-hmm. And it's not something that is used in static perimetry. And from the glaucoma perspective, bearing of blind spot does not have any meaning the way we do the static perimetry now.
Right. Okay. And how would you define slow progressors versus fast progressors? I'm sorry about this.
Any progression of 1 decibel per year or more than 1 decibel per year is considered as a significant progression. A fast progression would be more than 2 decibels per year. Based on the slope that you see, earlier we used to have the mean deviation slope on multiple fields. Now we have the VFI slope on multiple fields. So a rapid progressor is probably one who has more than 1.5 decibels, if you want to say, put that way, mean deviation.
Right, okay. Now, there is a question about guided progression analysis, which I think was beyond the scope of this
you
particular
can take it.
Talk. Yes. And sorry about that. Would Dr. Harsh or Dr. Pradeep have any comments here?
So we can take that guided progression analysis question also. If somebody has asked, let's answer.
Okay. The answer is please explain. I mean, it's all of it. Please explain GPA.
Okay. That will take half an hour, but I'll try to be brief and tell you. So the glaucoma progression analysis was an event-based analysis that was developed first. If more than 2 points, more than 3 points, three or more points are depressing beyond the statistical variation that can happen in an abnormal field, that was considered as an event-based analysis if it is happening more than twice. And this is the criteria that was used for early manifest glaucoma trial. That's the glaucoma progression analysis, which is an event-based analysis. Guided progression analysis is what we see of the VFI change over a period of time. And the guided progression analysis, like the examples that I showed you, before cataract surgery, after cataract surgery, rapid progression and stable field after that. So in the guided progression analysis, you have the VFI plotted over time, over the patient's age. And if you have more than 5 fields and more than 3 years of follow-up, you can actually predict what will happen to the visual field index over the next 5 years if you don't change your treatment. So if there is a downward slope, your patient is 50 years old, and there is a significant downward slope, you can see if you don't change the treatment in the next 5 years, the patient is going to lose so much of field. So because that's why in the guided progression analysis, if you see that change in front of you, you cannot procrastinate a definitive treatment that is required. So that's why it's called a guided progression analysis. So it's a VFI linear regression against the patient's age that will predict what will happen to the patient if you don't change the treatment over the next 5 years. The requirement is you need to have minimum 5 fields and minimum 3 years of follow-up.
Oh, there's another question that has come up just now. How important is visual field in giving disability certificate in cases like hereditary retinal diseases, RP, etc.?
So the central 10 degree visual field being affected is what the disability certificate talks about, even if the visual acuity is 20 over 20. So based on the 24-2 field, if the central 10 degree field is affected, or in a 10-2 program, if there is significant loss in the visual field, we can certify that as a disability certificate.
And how do you see the evolution of visual field in the future? What are the advances that are happening? And I would add any experience with ELISAR and the likes that quite a few people are actually using.
No experience with ELISAR. The best part that has happened probably with visual fields over a period of time is that the platform has not changed and we can continue to compare our patients' visual fields over a long period of time. All the imaging technologies, every 2 to 3 years, they change and you keep investing in new machines and forget the data that you have. This is a lifelong disease. I think that's the best thing that visual fields has done for us. What I would like to see is a better algorithm for visual field evaluation. There are progressions that have taken place with artificial intelligence rather than basing on Bayesian prior probability. Maybe there may be ways of doing the visual field evaluation even faster than what we do now.
Right. And, you know, you are saying that we've had visual fields for a long time, but then we have newer or, you know, other types of visual fields. When I say types, you know, I mean, you know, octopus also, which is present. So how do we compare these apples and oranges as they would be?
No, I think octopus and Humphrey are very robust, if I want to use the word gold standard, static perimetry that we have, vital signs and automated perimetry that we have. They use slightly different algorithms and slightly different background illumination and things like that. They cannot be compared with each other head to head, but you can make sense of whether the field that was done earlier in octopus, subsequently done in Humphrey, is significantly changed in a given time frame. Not easy, you'd need to spend a lot of time, but can be done. The newer or different kinds of perimetry like blue on yellow, frequency doubling technology, and so on and so forth, they have not stood the test of time in the context of following up a patient for a long period of time.
A lot of people keep asking that we cannot afford these expensive machines. And would it be worth buying some local made or a Chinese made machine, giving a bowel perimeter and maybe 1/4 the price? What would you say to them, sir?
So your practice will improve and you will find that 1/4 investment that you have made is actually waste of time and waste of money. You might as well wait for a couple of years and buy the more robust equipment rather than invest in something that you can't believe and your patient can't believe. Because there is no standardized normative database comparison, then the perimeter is useless. So investing money in those kinds of perimeters, if you spend 2 lakhs to buy that kind of an equipment, you may feel satisfied yourself that you are doing a visual field test, but it's actually not helping the patient and helping you. So hold on for some more time and buy something better. Meanwhile, there are visual field equipments available everywhere. You can just get it done.
Dr. Harsh?
Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying, that they can always refer. That's what sir is trying to say.
Yeah, I think we also, I think you made a comment that once a patient goes, they are worried that the patient will not come back.
And I told them that if you refer rightly, they will always come back and they'll bring 10 more people to them with them. because if you are right place, then
absolutely, there is absolutely no doubt about that. Patients understand the quality. They understand the standard of care given. There will always be the few loose cannon who don't, but by and large, I feel that is the case. Well, we are actually exhausted with the questions that have come through. I don't see any more. Do you want to make any further comments?
One last, sir, have you had the opportunity to work with this, what Ellen Robin had produced, or the MRF fields on the iPad? And any comments you want to make on those kind of screening tests?
A screening test in the primary care setup probably will be helpful. People are talking about the virtual reality headsets the visual fields being done with that. So Arvind has got one and we are validating one ourselves. Mm-hmm. So that I think is something that will be useful in the primary care setup to screen and diagnose established glaucoma. Mm-hmm. So I think there is a role for that. And if it can be done on an iPad and things like that, there are some that are there. The problem with these things is that they are developed, a couple of things are done, a lot of hype is created, and after that, nobody talks about them. So actually using them on the ground and proving that this can be done and utilizing them to pick up the early glaucomas is what is needed. The established glaucomas, not necessarily early glaucomas that are questionable treatment.
There was also a discussion we were having in the last talk, Dr. GC, about doing 10-2 in ocular hypertensives. And I suppose the paper that you quoted about Gustavo de Moraes was the one that was being talked about. Do you honestly believe that if you do not, are you not seeing any changes in the in your clinical examination in the rim and in the nerve fiber layer, then we are calling higher pressures ocular hypertensives. But if we are not doing a 10-2, we are doing them a disservice.
So the two important points that are necessary there. Number one is in your clinical examination, if you're looking at a relatively small disc, you are likely to miss a nerve fiber layer, miss a glaucomatous damage. You have to be extra careful there. The context in which the publication talks about is the Western practice where they ask for an OCT and do a 24-2 field. And if the OCT is only of the optic nerve and does not do the ganglion cell complex at the macula, like the structure function correlation thing that I showed, that the inferior vulnerable zone actually goes significantly into the macular area. So if you've done only the disc evaluation by OCT and only looking at the averages and not paying attention to the actual maps that show the nerve fiber layer defects and do a 24-2, you will miss them. So based on your clinical skills that I've seen and you're excellent in documenting everything, I don't think you will miss the ocular hypertensives, glaucomas as ocular hypertensives. That I'm not worried at all. But the point is, there are nerve fiber layer defects which can be missed if you don't do photographs and see them carefully, especially in some discs. And there is some debate. If you look at the ocular hypertension treatment study, their anatomical changes preceded the visual field changes. If you look at the early manifest glaucoma trial, their visual field changes preceded the anatomical changes. So in the clinic, what are we doing? How careful are we is the point. The average practitioner is not that careful. So you need to be careful is the point.
That's other than this particular hole that you just mentioned about, ordering an OCT and then correlating it with the 24-2, what other things I found in that particular paper is that they were very liberal with their reliability indices. a 33% all across fixation losses, false positives, false negatives, I thought was very liberal. And, you know, in reality, we would probably not accept that as a reliable field. That's one. And the second one is that, of course, it is over three centers of only African-American descent people. Now, not being prejudicial or biased in any way, but, you know, we all know this, you know, the level of education might be the determinant there as to how well the visual fields were performed. And in reality, I think we also face those kind of situations on a day-to-day basis. Would you agree with that, or am I reading too much?
I think the article talks about the defects being more in African-American descent than in Caucasian. They had Caucasian population also in that study, number one. Number two, we have done visual fields extensively in our rural population. So I wouldn't equate the quote-unquote literacy with the intelligence of being able to do or not able to do a visual field test.
It's not just the intelligence. I feel it's the understanding. You know, intelligence probably does not come into this. It's about how quick you are with the trigger, so to speak.
I'm telling you, a lot of rural people have done excellent visual fields. A lot of highly educated, sophisticated people go bonkers the moment they sit on the machine. So I don't think we can equate those two.
Yeah, I think you're stretching this point too much. There's no point discussing so much because it's basically a PG class. So can we say that, okay, in specific situations where things are not looking clear, maybe there are very mild changes which you are not sure of, and 24-2 is okay, we may do a 10-2 just to make sure that we are not missing something.
I would put it this way, that if you are doing a screening test for a glaucoma suspect in the first field, 24-2C probably is better than 24-2 alone. And if you see a functional structural abnormality on the disc evaluation, then based on that abnormality, you need to send them back for a 10-2 field.
Right. Okay. Any further points you want to make, Dr. Prateep, Dr. Harsh?
We just want to thank him for such a wonderful innings. And so many things were clarified. So it was really wonderful.
Yeah, the only thing is that 24-2C is not available with everyone. You know, it's available only in the high versions of the perimeter at 40 and beyond. So it's very expensive. And the other thing, you know, always, that is for PGs, you know, always adopt a good holistic approach and do the careful examination of the optic nerve head and the RNFL, and always prospectively think that what defect are you likely to get. And if you don't get that, then don't make an ego point and come back retrospectively and again re-examine your optic nerve head and the RNFL. And you will find that, yes, you have missed something. So that is what the approach you should have for all your patients. It was a wonderful lecture, and we have learned a lot, Dr. GC. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, Dr. GC, this is the culmination of our basic lectures where structure and function has been talked about. So I had promised all our hot seaters, as you know, we have a few of them who volunteer to be asked questions. So I have a question for them. You're welcome to stay, but if you are in a rush and hurry, we thank you for your presence. And we're indeed indebted for this very comprehensive talk on visual fields.
Thank you. I was only remembering the technology support who was worried about crossing the border. That's why I rushed through my presentation also to finish in time.
I'm a little late. It's
up to you guys.
He has to go before 9:10.
Yeah. Already 9:10.
Yeah, we have about 5 minutes, 5-10 minutes. Not a problem.
Yeah, so, sure.
Thank you. I will take leave then.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Good night. Okay, so all you hot seaters now, please get ready. You've had wonderful lectures on the basics of glaucoma. And so today now you're going to put it all together. I'm going to show you a disc. You need to guess what, you need to find out what the changes are, if there are any, and on based on that, predict where you would see in the optic nerve head, in the visual field, a defect, as well as on the OCT, where you would see depression of RNFL. So here we are. There are quite a few fallacies, unfortunately, where technology is concerned. That's why your clinics have to be absolutely spot on. I don't know why my, just a minute, I'll find my... I've got it up, but I'm not being able to see it. Why?
No, ma'am, you'll have to share your screen.
Yeah, I know I got to share my screen, but my desktop is not seeing. Ah, there it is. Sometimes you just have to shut it and restart. Here we are. Okay, we'll go slowly. No problem. Can you see the screen? No.
Ma'am, it just says that it is that you've started sharing the screen, but the screen is not.
It's a little slow. I don't know why. It had to play up today only. Just a minute.
Ma'am, would you like to take it for the next class? We'll keep like the 10 minutes.
I think we can do that.
Okay, ma'am. So, yeah. So everybody, so the next lecture will be on the May 26th, and that will be on anterior segment imaging, basic techniques, interpretation, and clinical applications by Dr. Arun Narayan Swamy. So we will see you on the May 26th.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
To all the attendees, the hot seaters, our chair, co-chair, and Rolika, you, of course. Thank you.
Thank you.